I have 9 tattoos. I got my first one when I was 18 for free. Long story, don't ask. And then basically just never stopped getting them. Here's a question. Have you heard of the term extremely online? Used as early as 2014. The phrase extremely online, usually capitalized, refers to people or the notion of being closely engaged with internet culture. It originates from a piece on the New Yorker from novelist Patricia Lockwood who said, if you've ever whispered to your cat to show the feet, sweetie, then you're extremely online. Well, yeah, tattoos are extremely permanent. And also let me know if you've ever whispered to your cat, show the feet, sweetie. Or if you consider yourself extremely online. I know I do, but I did just quit Twitter, log out permanently. I've had it with that fucking place. But yeah, let me know if you consider that yourself extremely online. Or if you have a cat and send me a anyway. So tattoos, as I was saying, they're extremely permanent. They're the definition of forever. And yes, I will be pretending that tattoo removal doesn't exist in this episode. Thank you for asking that. So this perpetual bond is understandably scary for a lot of people. I mean, unless they have an insecure attachment style, and being tied to something forever sounds like a dream. But again, let's pretend that doesn't happen, doesn't exist, just like tattoo removal. Yes. So here are some of the most common questions that people with tattoos get. If you do have tattoos, you've probably heard them. If you don't, you probably ask them. Did it hurt? What does it mean? Do you regret it? Are you the girl with a dragon tattoo? One of these things is not like the others. Yes, only one of them is an open-ended question. Great job, you're paying attention. Anyway, that being said, I don't regret any of my tattoos, in case you're wondering. And I have a guide if you want to know on how not to regret getting a tattoo. Whether you have an insecure attachment style is irrelevant. So, number one thing, get your first tattoo after you turn 18. No, a parent has not paid me to say this. I'm saying this on my own free will. Second, don't get tattoos related to a specific person. Three, if you're not 100% happy with the initial design of your tattoo, speak up. Speak up, no matter how intimidating or annoyed your tattoo artist seems. It really doesn't matter. Just speak up. And the fourth and last thing on how to not regret getting a tattoo or the tattoo you get is splurge. If there's one thing I suggest splurging on, it's tattoos. And yes, they're very expensive. And they're also extremely online. I mean, extremely permanent. So if you want to get one, just save up before you do. And anyway, so these four rules, in a way of mine, or tips, or whatever, there are exceptions to them. So if you're getting your niece's name tattooed, I mean, that's against the rule number two. So not getting tattoos related to a specific person, but I wouldn't, I mean, you would probably never regret it unless your niece turns up to be a little piece of, anyway, probably not. No, I don't, I'm not saying your niece is, no, your niece is the best. I love her. I don't know her, but I'm sure she is. And some people, again, to the first tip about not getting a tattoo before you're 18, some people are very mature for their age. They might know themselves very well at the age 15. No, they don't. I take it back. 18 is an arbitrary number, but it is a good starting point, I think, to reduce the chances of regretting your tattoo. So just 18, listen to me. And then maybe you can't afford to go get a tattoo at like the most expensive place or like the best place rather on your city, but you don't want to stop that from getting one. You don't want that to stop you from getting one, which is very understandable. And here's another tip then. So look into getting a tattoo in other countries, the ones with a lower cost of living. So amazing tattoos, for example, cost less in Albania than in the US, and they're still just as amazing. So, yeah. And I mean, now that we talked about those things, I would like to offer you a free tattoo. Idea, not a free tattoo. No. My lawyer told me not to say that. I don't have a lawyer, but I don't need one. That's good. I'm needing a lawyer. A free tattoo idea for your next tattoo or your first tattoo. And you don't even have to like call me or ask me or credit me or anything like that. So here it goes. Life was very different for me when I started my first full-time job. So here's a little explanation about depersonalization and derealization disorder. They occur when, and this is the definition actually from Mayo Clinic, so when you persistently or repeatedly have the feeling that you're observing yourself from outside your body, or you have a sense that things around you are unreal, or both. Feelings of depersonalization and derealization can be very disturbing and may feel like you're living in a dream. End quote. As long as I've talked about these with quite a few people throughout the years, actually, So long story short, as long as these episodes don't interfere your ability to function in society, you don't need to see a doctor. Obviously, that's not medical advice in any way. I don't have a lawyer, but I know enough not to say that. So it's common for people to experience these episodes throughout their lives, especially if they've had traumatic experiences. I've struggled with these feelings at specific points in time during my 16th birthday. Ooh, I'm getting goosebumps. When I started university and during the first and second month of my first full-time job. So I was working for a creative digital agency and a fast growing startup, so like the company kind of like owned both the agency and the startup. They were divided, so there were different things, but I worked on both. Sorry if you heard my burp. If you've seen Mad Men is a drama about one of New York's most prestigious ad agencies at the beginning of the 60s, focusing on one of the firm's most mysterious but extremely talented ad executives, Donald Draper. So anyway, as I started my first full-time job, I really felt like I was in the show in Mad Men. I'd actually listened to the Mad Men playlists at work. I was very creative. Things did move pretty quickly. I had to wear many hats, startups, you know how it goes. The pay was great for my first job. I loved the work. I was just like going all in. And I was also at the time, which sounds unbelievable now when I think about it, I was writing every single day, and I don't mean like in a journal or something like that, but actually publishing something on the Inner Dolphin every single day, from May 14th to June 19th. I wrote about why I stopped doing that. Oh, and I had also recently removed a sociopath from my life, and his house was within view of my workplace. So those feelings of depersonalization and yeah, persisted. I listened to the Madman playlist as I worked, as all these things were changing, and like I was just going through a phase, really. It's like a lot of people who get their first jobs will probably have some weird feelings associated with that. That's pretty normal. So I listened to the playlist, and there's like this song in it that I kept listening to.
What a little band of gold to prove that you are mine. Some sail away to Araby.
That's Band of Gold by Don Cherry. I even included it in an article I wrote a while, well, back then, about my favorite songs at the time and sex appeal. Yes. And strangely, I captioned this song specifically with very fond of the song that I found in a Madman playlist during an important, lovely period of my life. So I guess wrote this thing about like the favorite songs and sex appeal, not while I was on the job, but like a little later on, so maybe like a year after or something. And imagine that I referred to it as an important, lovely period of my life. And I mean, fucking perspectives, right? So that playlist actually introduced me to the song, the lyrics of which I wanted to get tattooed, I mean, back then, which I decided to share with you today. So happy listening to this song. I'll be back. Don't go anywhere. Listen to the song, okay? Hold on.
I remember when I was a little girl and our house caught on fire. I'll never forget the look on my father's face as he gathered me in his arms and rushed to the burning building on the pavement. And I stood there, shivering in my pajamas, watched the whole world go up in flames. And when it was all over, I said to myself, is that all there is to a fire? Is that all there is? Is that all there is? If that's all there is, my friends, then let's keep dancing. Let's break out the booze and have a ball. If that's all there is. And when I was 12 years old, my daddy took me to the circus, the greatest show on earth. There were clowns and elephants and dancing bears, and a beautiful lady in pink tights flew high above our heads. But as I sat there watching, I had the feeling that something was missing. I don't know what, but when it was all over, I said to myself, is that all there is to the circus? Is that all?
Have a ball. If that's all.
wonderful boy in the world. We'd take long walks down by the river, just sit for hours gazing into each other's eyes. We were so very much in love. And then one day, he went away and I thought I'd die. But I didn't. And when I didn't, I said to myself, is that all there is to love? Is that...
I hope you listened. I listened and listened and listened and listened to this song back then, taking in every word. I listened to it at work, on my way to work, on my way to go out, on my way home from going out. And reviews aren't my strongest suit, so let's just say Peggy Lee's voice and artistic journey have already received a well-deserved myriad of accolades. She was brilliant. I'd actually also suggest finding the song on YouTube, Peggy Lee's That All There Is, 1969. And looking at the comments, I got goosebumps. And during that strange period of my life, I found comfort in her words. When you first listen to the song, I'm not sure if that was your first time listening or not, the lyrics may seem a little like negative or fatalistic or apathetic in a way, and it may seem like Peggy is downplaying how beautiful life can be. Art is extremely subjective, so maybe that is right, actually. But in the midst of chaos, the constancy and predictability of the song of Is That All There Is brought me peace back then. Peggy was right. Just like she said, like, their house got on fire when she was a little girl. And as her father gathered her up in his arms, raced through the building, she stood there shivering in the pajamas and, like, said to herself, is that all there is to a fire? I'm not gonna play the song from the beginning again, but, when I was a little girl, our house caught on fire too. I think when I was 5 or maybe 4. So we just moved with my parents from Shkodër, which is where I'm from, to Tirana, so the capital of Albania. And so this thing happened, the house caught on fire. And I also stood there shivering in my pajamas, watching the whole world and the house go up in flames. And this happened around like 3 a.m. or something. And I wanted to get Is That All There Is to a Fire, just like Peggy Lee sang in that song, tattooed on me. So maybe I'm so fond of this specific string of words because I've also watched the whole world go up in flames, literally and metaphorically. And I love it. I don't know. I love it. And I think you can apply this to anything bad. So eating disorders, panic attacks, natural disasters, heartbreak, addiction, abusive relationships, health problems. And like I said, that the truth of the predictability of Is That All There Is brought me peace back then. Because it's true that no matter how much you feel like your life is ruined or like nothing will be okay again, it does eventually get better. This is something that I really believe in, a truism for me. It's a constant truth of human nature that we're resilient. We fall down, we get back up. It's just in our nature. And while we might not make it through the jungle without a scratch, we somehow always make it through. So looking back, I know I do like a year, 2 years, 3 years later, you just like have a little smile on your face and you can say like, is that all there is to a fire? And I think that's tattoo worthy for sure. So yeah, get that tattooed if you want. Thanks for listening.